Yah is my strength and power, and he maketh my way perfect. 2 Samuel chapter 22, verse 33. My flesh and my heart faileth, but Yah is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Psalms chapter 73, verse 26. Graduating from college with a master's, bachelor's, or doctorate is not what makes a person strong. Having your own place to stay and being the sole monetary provider for your household is not what makes a person strong. Having the ability to take care of yourself and your children without the aid of a man or male figure is not what makes a person strong. Moving from the projects to the suburbs is not what makes a person strong. But these are all definitions of what could possibly make a person weak if it is the priority of their lives. See, the man who did not make Yah his strength, but trusted in his many riches, being strong in his destruction. Psalms chapter 52, verse 7. A strong person is the one who can not only master making Yah his or her priority in life above all things, but can stand on that belief no matter what consequences or persecutions may bring. Those people have the ability to agree with Yah no matter what opinions or views others may feel or what traditions may currently exist, and to resist temptation in all its forms. There are many times in our walks where we are at our strongest and when we are at our weakest. But going from the ghetto working at McDonald's to a corporate six-figure salary has nothing to do with strength, ladies. Strength lies not in our ability to rise, but in Yah, in the humility to accept what we cannot change, the courage to modify what we can, the heart to understand the difference between the two, and like a waterfall, start over and over and over again, even if only to anticipate another fall.
There's some things we have to deal with ourselves internally that we haven't dealt with, so we lash out. And as black women, I know there are a lot of angry black women because some of them are my friends. So in that respect, I think we really need to look at ourselves, and I think that's something that we're not doing. And until we do that, then we can deal with the issues of what's going on with the black family, period, where our relationships don't work.
Another aspect of submission is the way we carry ourselves. It is important that we dress in a way that will show our inside submission as well as our outside. Your adornment should not be outward, arranging the hair, wearing gold, or putting on dresses, but the hidden man of the heart with the incorruptible ornament of a meek and peaceful spirit, which is of great value before Yah. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 3 through 4. This scripture does not imply that a woman cannot wear braids or jewelry or dresses, but that these should not be the foundation from which we base our character. As we've guessed, feminism, of course, gave way to the idea that women can dress as whorish as their nasty hearts desired. How do we go from the public dehumanization of Hebrew women such as Sarah Bartman to the open and accepted self-dehumanization of ourselves such as the video vixen?
Gentlemen.
Her name was Sarah Bartman.
That sun is hot and plenty bright. Let's get out of business and get home tonight, gentlemen.
She went to Europe willingly, thinking she would find riches and fame. They fooled her.
Auctioning slaves with a real high heart. Bring that young gal, Roy. She's good for a start. Gentlemen.
In Europe, she found humiliation, forced to be a spectacle because many of them had never seen a naked black woman's body. They nicknamed her Hottentot Venus. They were fascinated by her large, full breasts, big hips, buttocks, and big lips. They stared, touched, and laughed. She couldn't really be human because she didn't look like a white woman.
Now here's a real goodbye. On about 15, her great-grandmammy was a die-homie queen. Just look at her face, she sure ain't homely. Like Sheba in the Bible, she's black but homely, bitter man. Gonna start at 3, can I hear 3? Step up 10, take a good look, see, cause I know you want her once you see her. She's young and right, make a darn good breeder, bitter man. She's good in the field, she can sew and cook. Strip her down raw and let the gentleman look. She's full up front and ample behind. Examine her teeth if you got a man. Bid him in, get him in. Here's a bit of street for a man who's thrifty. 325 can I hear 350. Your money ain't earning you much in the bank. Turn her around raw and let him look at her flanks. Bid him in.
Doctors and medical students scored madly in the medical journals' descriptions of her body. She was later sold to a circus where she danced naked for the entertainment of white people. In their mind, her large breasts, buttocks, and her elongated labia made her inferior and oversexed. This justified their inhumane treatment of the black man and the black woman.
$350 is beating them looking for four, and $400 is a bargain, sure. Four is a beat, $450, $500 now looking like, beat them in, get them in. Don't mind them tears, that's one of her tricks. $550 is beating, who say six? She's healthy and strong and well-equipped. Make a fine lady's maid when she's properly whipped, beat them in.
No longer wanted in the circus, she became a prostitute and later died from loneliness, shame, and disease. She had been in Europe for only 5 years. And was only 25 when she died. But her story doesn't end there. Even in death, she wasn't allowed dignity. Europeans were fascinated and obsessed with Sarah Bartman. When she died, they cut out her vagina, her brain, her skeleton, preserved them in jars, and placed them all on display, along with a plaster of her actual body. For 160 years, people could walk into a museum, look at Sarah Bartman's vagina, her brain, her skeleton, and see what she looked like naked. In 1974, they took down the display, but they still kept her remains. It wasn't until 2002 that her remains were returned to her home and given a long overdue proper burial. Some would say Hottentot Venus, a.k.a. Sarah Bartman, was one of the first video vixens. Before television or radio, Sarah Bartman became the blueprint for degrading and humiliating the black woman on a worldwide level.
$650, don't be through. Seven is the bid, gonna let her go. At seven, she's going, gone. Pull her down, Robert, bring the next one on. Bid them in, get them in, bid them in.
Of course, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to understand that with dressing like a whore comes other whorish attributes, such as performing as one in the bedroom. Sex was a big part of the feminist development, the idea that women could be as promiscuous as possible as they fled their so-called sexual oppression. Feminism promotes women to be adulterers, that because men sleep around with different women, it's somehow okay, and that it gives women the right to sleep around with different men. It also promotes the lesbian agenda. And so, you cannot be a feminist and not be a whore or a lesbian. It's all over the internet and inside of books. Just pick one up and find out for yourself. That feminism, lesbianism, and whoredom are all one and the same. Elizabeth Emarth, a Saintsbury professor of English literature at the University of Edinburgh, Scotland, defines a feminist as a woman who treats women, therefore herself, with respect. Emarth further explains that this definition hinges primarily on a woman's relationships with other women, not on her relationships with men. A writer notes this about Elizabeth's definition of feminism. Emarth's definition of feminism is troublesome because she excludes men. The whole point of the feminist movement is equality among the sexes, not exclusion based on gender. Feminists cannot both insist on inclusion of women while at the same time demanding the exclusion of men and still be taken seriously. Dear writer, that's because feminism is the exclusion of men. Bell Hooks, a scholar teaching at the City College of New York, defines feminism as both a movement to end sexism and a movement to end sexual oppression. She says that sexism refers to gender discrimination, whereas sexual oppression involves what Hooks refers to as power gained through the exploitation and oppression of others. Hooks does not see men as the enemy, but sees sexism and sexual oppression as the issue. Is it just me, or does that statement contradict itself? Scripture tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 verses 4 through 5 that as husband and wife we should not deprive each other as not to give room for sin. That the marriage bed is undefiled. And Scripture also tells us that if we cannot have self-control over our bodies, that we should marry because it is better to marry than to sin. So it's not like Father Yah didn't take our fleshly needs into consideration. He gives men and women instruction on how to behave themselves, even as going far as to say the marriage bed is undefiled. With the exception of animals and homosexuality, there are no rules in the bedroom. So when feminists say that women are sexually oppressed, what are they talking about? I think we all know the answer to that question. I do not need to elaborate.
What do you think feminists are?
Lesbians.
Oh, lesbians.
Yeah. First of all, they got their amendment passed in 1920. Why are they still bitching about female rights?
Probably militant, angry women trying to get their way in the world.
What I think a feminist is?
Yeah.
I'm going to just go with the lesbian thing.
You ever called yourself a feminist?
No, I think I guess a feminist to me would be like someone, a woman that believes in women's rights, I guess. That's what it is to me.
But you wouldn't identify yourself as one?
No.
And do you think there's a need for feminism?
No, sir, I don't think so. I think the Bible say very clear the man is the head of a household.
Why you say that?
Because, man, Jordan's too damn sassy and independent, man.
Hey, man, I love Jordan. You know that, right? But let's face it, dog. A woman like that don't need no man. No, man, she's one step from lesbian.
Oh!
Oh!
Yeah, the role of a woman is to be a helper to her husband. That's the original reason that we were created from Adam's rib, if you will. So we're supposed to be there for our husbands, whatever he needs us to do. If that's cooking his meals, if that's cleaning the house, if that's taking care of the children, he's supposed to be able to trust in us.
Feminism is taken away or subtracted from the male role. Feminism is taking over the male role. Mm-hmm. Feminism is reforming things so that the male is no longer needed. Mm-hmm. Feminist is little boys seeing strong women and wanting to be that.
The number of businesses owned by black women jumped 75% compared to 29% for black men. And so it's no wonder that of $850 billion of spending power in the African American community, today black women control 62% of that.
There's another interesting statistic. 70% of, this is, I know, all the black women, hold on to your seats right now. All the black women, hold on, take a breath. 70% of African American women are single.
You will stay a slave?
I'm gonna stay alive. I'm gonna stay warm instead of cold. I'm gonna stay fed instead of starved. I'm gonna stay. I'll do what they say long as I can suck breath. A dead nigga ain't help nobody. Least of all a dead nigga.
It is also important for us to understand that submission does not lie in respecting our husbands only, but men in general. As well as understanding that a successful marriage is not necessarily one that is in order. The act of submission is so powerful that a marriage can last simply because it exists, and not all the time is the woman the one taking over that role.
Need some money.
Can I help you?
Yeah,
you're
trying to
fly with
FEMA?
Yeah, FEMA, just go around the desk right there.
Need some money. I need some money, honey. I need some money right away.
You're still waiting.
Yes. Kimberly Rivers?
Kimberly Rivers?
Yes, Kimberly. You have registered.
Yeah.
Do you always have TV cameras for you?
Yeah, you
do. Okay. Yes, you should have received it by now, but it does sound like you do need to check your files on the computer here. Hopefully you've not somehow gone off into some limbo land and without any information.
I need the income.
Yeah, well, I don't want to raise your expectations too high. Did you provide them banking information or route number?
No, I have no bank account.
Okay. This is a little bit unusual that the check was approved over a week ago. So, sorry. Secret sheet.
Because there's no good black men out there.
There's no good black men?
I haven't found any.
African American women are independent. And because of that, it's like they don't submit themselves to the men like African women, you know. Most African women submit themselves to their husband and have less issues than the African American woman.
We've been programmed. Programmed so deep that it feels impossible to look past the hurt. The confusion that has shaped so many of our lives. From waiting to exhale to colored girls who considered suicide when the rainbow was enough, we are selfish in our pain. We never consider the hurt that lies on the other side. Never, never do we take the time to step out of our shoes to see what the whips really feel like. But imagine that you cannot see your children, raise them, watch them grow. Imagine that you could not take part in their daily lives. You could not touch them, kiss them, love them, know that they are okay. Now imagine walking into a job interview and being rejected because you've been in jail before. Imagine that next the demons catch you and you find yourself strung out on somebody's corner. And by now it's too late to see them because they hate you now. They hate you because daddy taught them to hate you. Then imagine turning on the TV or the radio and watching your life being played out on BET's new drama series. To your astonishment, you've been multiplied. You're a fool, a homosexual, a rapist, a murderer, a dog, a jailbait. And you can't escape it because the revolution has been televised. And you're this person everywhere you go. The tension in the air from the cold stairs, they never go away. They never go away. Not even when you come home and he's staring you the same way. And it doesn't matter how good of a person you are now because your sins have been broadcasted so everyone thinks they know who you are. And all you wanted to do was raise your children with somebody, someone who wouldn't look at you the same way others are looking at you. Now open your eyes. That's the life of a so-called black man. The same black man whose scars are much deeper than the ones you choose to wear on your sleeves, and much more salty than the tears you cry on someone's shoulder. That's a life that, fortunate for us ladies, we will never experience. In closing, once we begin the process of reading the Bible for ourselves and research, we'll see that being submissive is not a bad thing. It does not imply that those submissive women are weak and docile, but that they agree. Yes, I submit to my husband, but it does not mean that I don't have an opinion and suggestions. But he makes the final decisions because it's the natural order of things. Men are the heads of our households, whether they are the primary bread bearer or not, that's the order. But they need you, ladies. The so-called black man, the Hebrew man, he needs you. He needs the neck to support the head and to be able to hold him down when the world is throwing him down. We will never know what it means to be a man, especially a so-called black one. We'll never know how it feels to have a target, red dot, stereotypes, criticisms everywhere we go. The least we could do is to ensure that those criticisms don't come from within. The least we can do is to make our Hebrew men feel like kings when they come home. must they not at least get stopped?
We're back now with our series. All this week we'll be reporting on African-American women and where they stand. We begin tonight with the critical issue of education, where there's an achievement gap developing that's hard not to notice. Almost two-thirds of all African-American undergraduates these days are women.
Jackson says her degree from Stanford University is one of her greatest assets.
The breaking process of the African woman. Take the female and run a series of tests on her to see if she will submit to your desires willingly. Test her in every way because she is the most important factor for good economics. When in complete submission, she will train her offspring in the early years to submit.
People look and they see it and they say, oh, okay, I recognize this, and it's almost that stamp of approval.
All accounts, the reasons for the disparities are complicated, but some blame schools, charging they often give up on African-American males at the elementary level. Plus, in a society that celebrates bad boy images, many black males, experts say, get the idea that dropping out of school is better than staying in.
Male and female role reversal 101. For fear for the young male's life, she will psychologically train him to be mentally weak and dependent, but physically strong. Because she has become psychologically independent, she will train her female offspring to be psychologically independent. What have you got? You've got the nigger woman out in front and the nigger man behind and scared.
If you create a large underculture of unemployable male, only negative revolution can occur.
But Mia Jackson's hoping the positive revolution continues for young black women, like her own daughter, a sophomore at Stanford University. Experts say the gender disparity and economic achievement for blacks is rooted in education.
1965, U.S. Department of Labor. The fundamental problem is that of family structure. Negro family life in the urban ghettos is crumbling. For vast numbers of unskilled, poorly educated city working class, the fabric of conventional social relationships has all but disintegrated. So long as this situation persists, the cycle of poverty and disadvantage will continue to repeat itself. 1965, U.S. Department of Labor. A fundamental fact of Negro American family life is the often reversed roles of husband and wife. Matriarchy.
Part of this statistic of African American women achievement.
This is true.
We're talking about you, Jackie. Mm-hmm. What will happen in relationships for African American women when you have so many African American women who have they're educated mm-hmm. and gainfully employed? Mm-hmm. Will there be African American men who can stand beside them? Is there a gap, if you will, in finances and education, or will you accept a partner who academically hasn't achieved as much as you've achieved, and economically who hasn't achieved as much as you've achieved?
That's a hard pill to swallow.
Yeah, you know what I would say? I would say, would they accept me? Because a lot of men are afraid of women who have a college education, who are making 5 to 6 figures, so they intimidate. But society and the way of life puts us in that position.
1712, the Willie Lynch letter. By reversing the positions of the male and female savages, we created an orbiting cycle that turns on its own axis forever, unless a phenomenon occurred and reshifts positions of the male and female savages.
As women that have achieved as much as they have, they are on a pedestal, so no one can knock them down, or they think they're better than you are. And that's what men are looking at. But then think about it, statistically, years ago, right, men were doing it. But now the women are doing it, and they can't stand it.
1965, U.S. Department of Labor. What then is the problem? We feel the answer is clear enough. 3 centuries of injustice have brought about deep-seated structural distortions in the life of the Negro American. At this point, the present tangle of pathology is capable of perpetuating itself without assistance from the white world. The cycle can be broken only if these distortions are set right. 1965, U.S. Department of Labor. In essence, the Negro community has been forced into a matriarchal structure which, because it is too out of line with the rest of American society, seriously retards the progress of the group as a whole and imposes a crushing burden on the Negro male, in consequence, on a great and many Negro women as well.
That's their insecurity. And no matter what a woman tells a man, no, I love you because of this. It doesn't matter what I have, because when we're one, we have it. It's not I. It's no I. It's we have it. But that's not good enough. It's unacceptable for them. And you go to a different race because that other race accepts them for who they are, not for the education, not for how much money they're making. They accept them for them.
You know, do my own Friendster, my own MySpace, and do a page for my own dating interests, and I wanted to find other women sort of like me. You know, there's a huge world out there, and there's all sorts of men who are attractive, handsome, with a job, you know, great schooling, good hair, you know, all those wonderful things, and I'm free to date all of them.
Warning of phenomenon. By reversing the positions of the male and female savages, we created an orbiting cycle that turns on its own axis forever unless a phenomenon occurred and reshifts positions of the male and female savages. Our experts warned us about the possibility of this phenomenon occurring, for they say that the mind has a strong drive to correct and recorrect itself over a period of time, if it can touch some substantial original historical base. The phenomenon is the knowledge of Yah's truth. John chapter 8, verse 32 says, "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free."
Look at this movie and say it ain't real.
They shouldn't look at it and say it isn't real. It's an issue. It's a real issue.